Welcome everyone to the Archon Team League Championships. We're on to phase two. This is going to be the last match of phase two, which should be kind of exciting. With me today is Dog. I don't think we've ever casted together. How are you doing, man?
I think we have. I'm pretty good. You know, woke up a little refreshed, had some coffee, ready to watch some good Hearthstone.
Yeah, gotta get some coffee, right? Started the day off. So did you watch the games that happened yesterday, or were you not following those like super closely?
I watched some of them. They're pretty good. A couple wonky decks. We had the, you know, Paladin with Secrets and Eloise's weird Warlock with Shield Bearer or something. That was
Shield Bearer and Fist of Jiraxis. Yeah, the whole discard shenanigan. Like, no Tiny Knights of Evil and Succubus, but it was pretty unusual. Although they did move on, so it's going to be kind of interesting to see what they bring for the live finale. Now, Nihilim yesterday lost, so they're going to have to go through the crucible of beating another team yet to have a chance to get to the live finale, and that team is going to be Forsen Boys, which, you know, they did win yesterday against Team Archon, who got knocked out of the event. So going forward, you know, they're still stuck with the same decks today. Then they'll be able to change them for the last phase, obviously. So we already know what those decks are that they're playing today. It's going to be a little interesting to see how they, you know, pan out, because all those players have been adapting some of their strategies based on new TGT cards, and it's not always been optimized just yet, right? Yeah. Like the whole metagame is a bit in flux.
The interesting thing about this part right now, though, is the players couldn't change their decks, right?
Yep.
So I'm sure what they did is they just watched the VODs, they made the lists, they copied every single card, so everyone's going to know everyone's deck, and it'll be interesting how they, like, approach the matchups and what they want to put in first, what they think they're favored against, things like that.
Yeah, so when you have perfect information, it's easier to navigate, you know, your matches, obviously. So guys, before we move on with the actual game itself, we'll be showing you a recap of what's happened so far in the league. So if you guys haven't really followed everything, you'll get a chance to get maybe some of the highlights. Prepare for the Patron Warriors. We'll be right back after the video. Enjoy. He was pretty focused.
Yeah.
Attacking to something might matter. And turns out he just wants to go face and is that. Oh my god, the blowout.
He played it. Yeah, we saw no win condition for him anymore. And he missed.
He's like out of steam. And he has Hellfire Healbot next turn.
Oh, wow.
Oh my god, the top decks are real.
Look at that, RD.
This is a silly day.
Yeah. This is crazy. This is just, I don't know.
Like, can we get like Shia LaBeouf on a green screen saying that? And
front?
Whoa. Oh, there it is! There's the reaction!
Playwright, that could actually.
Oh, so he's hoping for the concede. He's agonizing Trump. Well played. Well played. Yeah, like you are. That's it.
And Giara's gonna concede it, and Value
Triple Bench
goes for the crazy reverse sweep. Alex has to die.
No way. We already saw one Doomsayer today. Not possible.
Okay.
Oh my god!
Is it not? It's just barely short, right? Oh my gosh. Oh my
what
god.
Fraud that's gotta be hard
for me. No matter what. The thing is, if the Doomguard comes out, you're forcing Shadow Ward Death, in which case Cabal is a bit less.
Which is fine.
It's okay for misplay. Yeah. Yeah. Miss exactly. One damage. You could have traded Abusive first, but he's trading anyway.
Yeah, you got it.
Actually, no, he healed a minion, so it's a hit for six.
Ooh!
Oh, wait.
Oh, he's one off.
And that one miss damage actually hot cost him the game.
Yeah. All right, welcome back. I hope you enjoyed the video. Now, before we move on to words, a quick shout out to our partners from AlphaDraft.com, the Esports Fantasy League. If you want to check them out, obviously, AlphaDraft.com, you have a chance to get a share of the $300,000 they give away each week. And they can match your initial deposit by up to $250. Not too bad. There's also Amazon App Store, which is doing a giveaway for 50% discount on card pack. So give it a shot. tmarkon.com/Amazon or amazon.com/Hearthstone. Now that this is out of the way, do you have any thoughts about the current format? You know, that we're going forward into this, like the best of 11, that's been, I guess, standard in the league so far. Do you think it's going to be like higher pressure going to live finals, knowing that you have to depend on your team, and the stakes are really high. I mean, you're playing in the event, so
yeah. I don't know. Most of the time when I lose, I'm more like upset for myself because I lost for my team. Like, I'm not
okay.
It's more pressure because there's a team aspect to it. I don't really like, I care if I lose, obviously, but it's added pressure that I have a team. As for this format, I don't know. I've played this format for, like, I guess the entire league or whatever, and I'm still not used to it. It's kind of hard to pinpoint. It's hard to figure out.
Yeah, I mean, it's a single-player game, and you're having to depend on other players, and they depend on you for their performance overall. So this is Phase 2. You know, Phase 1's already been done. We had the round robin with every single team facing off against each other. We've had Match 1 of Phase 2 with Team Archon versus Temple Storm to decide who would move on. And then Temple Storm is going to make it to the live finale. The current standings show that Cloud9 and Value Town, and that includes you, Dog,
yes,
are pretty safe, you know, for the live finale spots. But there's still a chance that, Nihilum can make it there, or Force and Boys. Temple Storm is guaranteed. Team Archon is actually out, so depending, I mean, these standings don't reflect who's going to make it to the live finale. Team Archon was eliminated yesterday. So if Nihilum makes it through, they're going to have a really sick culmination to a crazy roller coaster ride they've been running through, going from the top of the standings, I think, down to the bottom. And then
they've been top like the entire season. It'd be kind of a shame if they didn't make it.
Yeah, I wonder how they're going to take it if they don't. And the worst feeling must be if they win today and they go to the live finale and they finish fourth place. That's going to feel horrible, I think. All right. So looking at the lineups here from Nihilum and Force and Boys, same decks as yesterday. Life Coach playing a Control Paladin and a Patron Warrior. RDU.
I think he's playing Control Warrior, right? I think that was the switch.
Was that him playing Control Warrior yesterday?
I'm pretty sure it was.
Why, sure. Maybe. See, you say you didn't follow the games, but if
figure
you...
Figure it out.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure he did. We'll see.
All right.
We'll figure it out. Yeah.
So we got RDU on Shaman with Mech, right?
Yeah, I think so.
Can it be anything but Mech? Really, these days? Like,
I mean,
is it ever?
TGT came out. Got new stuff. Can avoid the cancer stuff.
All right, so you could imagine somebody bringing like a totem deck to a tournament. I mean, I think there's definitely an archetype lurking there, right? But the thing is, we were talking about this with RDU yesterday, and it turns out his thoughts on the matter basically go along the lines of, I'm going to play Mech Shaman, and I'm going to put Tuskar Totemic in. So it's a little
yeah,
disheartening.
Yeah, that was kind of weird. I saw that. I was like, that's not going to help you top deck lethal. A little totemic.
Yeah. It's a pretty good card. I mean, it's almost too high variance to be to be real sometimes. You know, Totem Golem comes out on that fateful turn. All right, so Skaka playing Warrior versus the Hunter from RDU. That favors the Warrior quite a lot, I'd say, right?
Yeah, it's really, really favored if you're running just straight face Hunter, like Patron wins that matchup so many times, like 80%, or I don't know, I'm just making up a really high percentage there. But yeah, so they usually win that matchup. Hybrid's a little harder, but it's still fairly easy. Or not easy, but still favorite.
Do you have a like an analyst? Like, have you mapped out all the matchups in Value Town? Like, I know you guys have been, being quite... You've been doing super well, honestly. It's kind of like the unexpected, no pun intended, underdogs just wrecking... Wait. Through the tournament.
I think Trump has a spreadsheet, and he consults the spreadsheet, and then he linked the spreadsheet, and it was just like a bunch of percentages based on all the tournament results. And then he was just like, so we should go with this statistically. And I'm just like, I'm not going to not play Rogue Trump. So, yeah.
So that's the reason we saw Rogue pretty much every single week.
Exactly. Okay. But you know, we can go with our gut feeling.
Speaking of Rogue, you know, this game is kind of slow. So I have a question. Do you think TGT did anything good for Rogue at all?
Well, it changed the way other people build their decks, so it's a little slower, and Rogue has a little more time to react. They also aren't playing cards that are very like aggressive and do much. They're playing slow cards like Dragons, so stat becomes a lot more relevant. So, and the fact that the way people are building decks, it helped Rogue a lot. The actual cards that were added did not help Rogue at all. I would build Rogue the exact same way I did prior to TGT.
All right, well, hopefully we see some innovations on that front in the near future, but I think a lot of people would tend to agree. All right, so Skaka starting with a removal heavy hand, no weapons, of course, but when you've got an unstable ghoul, that's already a pretty sick start against a hunter. You're usually very comfortable, and double slam also can carry him for a little longer.
Yeah, he pointed out that ghoul against the leopard was just pretty good, and the fact that he had the slam to get the freezing trap on that is so huge, because you don't want that ghoul to be frozen, because it's like not a good unit to get frozen, obviously, and you don't really want to waste a kill command or a quick shot on it. It's a bad situation for the hunter, and it was worse right now.
Yeah, everything. Like, Oskaka puts his opponent in a position where there's really no answer here but a bow. And a bow feels kind of awful, because the ghoul already took what it wanted to take, which is that one drop Lepronome. So even if you do play the bow, you're just wasting a charge on a minion that the warrior doesn't need anymore. And can you afford
to kill command
this?
Or like quick shot it? I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, can you afford the freezing trap being eaten by it as well, right?
What are you expecting next turn? You're expecting a frothing?
An acolyte or a frothing,
yeah. So it looks like he wants that frozen. And I kind of agree with that. I'm not sure if I agree with using the kill command over the quick shot, but I think that's, I mean, it's fine.
By the way, you're right. That warrior was the warrior without Grom and Alexstrasza that Life Coach was playing yesterday.
He doesn't run Grom and Alexstrasza? What?
don't ask me. I am not the one who made the deck. It was very surprising to me.
I saw a zombie Chow. I remember that.
No, you didn't see that. You saw the one drop, 1-2. That was supposed to be...
That was in the Paladin deck. That was the Inspire, yeah.
So he likes to run those.
Alright, I think if a 3-attack minion comes out, then RDU's in an okay spot. Wait, that's 3 damage to zero power? That's pretty cool.
This is hell. Alright, Justicar's True Heart in the form of a 2-drop. RDU is pretty happy about that one, knows that he kind of baited a slam out of his opponent as a result of this coming out. You can't feed a Dread Corsair into it, and that's a pretty good top deck for RDU.
I wonder if he's running high mains. He might have cut the high main for a little lower curve, because I think he was running Chargers. And it could be hybrid, but you don't really run hybrid with Argent Squires.
It's an interesting take on the, like, the 1-1s really help a lot because you're running the abusive. You know, it's not a card you see put in every single hunter deck, but the people that do include the Ardent Squire tend to get pretty good success with it, just because abusive lets you trade up so nicely against decks, say like Patron Warrior, where you can remove an Armor Smith a little earlier, you can deal with Acolytes of Pain nicely. Yeah, like this Dread Corsair is just going down, and you're not losing.
You just dump your hands and hope he doesn't have a Whirlwind.
I think you have a point, because if you just cycle everything, you should.
You can let a one-one live if you do this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can do. You can just do everything. The question is there a reason to just maybe Hero Power instead, or is that not worth it?
It depends how high your curve is. If you think that you might draw into a high main or something, then you shouldn't Hero Power. If you're running Shredders, high mains, things like that, you're not going to be able to dump your hands every turn, so Hero Power like becomes irrelevant. Or not irrelevant, but you want to cycle into the cards that help you earlier.
Yeah, it makes sense. So Skaka's in a bit of an awkward position, because he can remove the board alright, but he can't draw anymore. And unless he can, you know, throw back the pressure the hunter's way, he's the one who's going to start falling behind a little bit.
How do you feel about Emperor and Execute?
Over the Deathbite? Yeah, I think you're forcing your opponent to either go all in on your face or spend a lot of resources removing the 5-5, depending.
The thing is that the Emperor doesn't really do anything aside from the body because he has one card in hand. and there is a freezing, yes.
Yeah, maybe Death Bite Execute Armor Up is better because you kind of need the extra health going forward if you expect this to last long. And getting that Whirlwind effect off of the Death Bite should probably be enough to clean up the board next turn. Seems like that would be the way to go.
Plus, you could draw into a Patron, Acolyte, anything like that. So, I do like this.
Yeah, you're right, because the moment you find another... even a Battle Rage would be fine.
Mm-hmm.
Because you can play Emperor and then Battle Rage it, if you'd like.
Thinks that Execute is worth more than 4 HP.
That's interesting. Against a Hunter. I value my HP a lot.
It's a good card. It's time to smork.
When is it not, though? That's the question, right? Time to smork.
Hey, we can't make fun of the Hunter. There's only one place to attack.
Yeah, you're right. But that's the good, because he can't misplay. There can't be a misplay if there's no minions on the board. RDU is thinking.
He's not sure if he wants to commit the Animal Companion to board, because... it gets cleared by the Death Bite, so he loses all board immediately if he does play it. And if he gets a Misha, it doesn't really do that much. It pushes 4 damage. If he gets a Hufford, he's rewarded a lot. If he gets a Leok, he's kind of rewarded.
Well, Leok is basically the same as Misha, because the warrior takes 2 from the Leok and 3 from the board. So it kind of adds up to 1 extra damage, which is 5, basically.
So he values the unit more than the damage possibility.
I kind of like this because it's forcing the warrior to deal with another wave of incoming damage afterwards. That's going to be a little painful, though.
Yeah, that's like not really what you want to be despiting.
Do you push the face and double drop?
I think you need to be armoring, but at the same time, you need board to deal with whatever he plays.
Yeah, the thing about the Unstable Ghoul is that it can also eat up the Freezing Trap instead of your Emperor, but if you feel like you need the health, then using the armor up and delaying the Ghoul might be just perfectly fine.
Yeah.
Oh, man. So, Oskaka did see one kill command, right? So he can't be that afraid of...
dying.
Like getting... yeah, just dying just yet.
Yeah.
It's gonna be a slow grind if the Hunter gets the game, I think.
Do you know if he was running any Wolf Riders or anything? Just like aggressive? Because like he had a bunch of early game, like the Squire and stuff, but I'm not actually sure if I saw any Chargers ever.
He might have decided to keep the Arcane Golems because they're pushing more effective damage per slot. So maybe he doesn't run the Wolf Riders on top.
It's actually a really good draw, the Acolyte.
Yeah, it's going to allow him to maybe cycle further. Not a bad pickup for RDU either, though.
Yeah, it's just a solid job. You have to go face here and shoot. I think the Patron is probably going to win this game.
Yeah, it all depends on whether or not he's able to swing back, because that Freezing Trap is going to delay him a little bit. That Execute, however, helps quite a lot, and the trade on Lotheb is pretty obvious. Oh, wow. Okay.
You can just bounce back your Acolyte. Execute trade. Play your
Would you ever? Would you ever consider executing Misha and then bouncing back Emperor, attacking and into Lothep? Yeah, and then executing enough for another 6.
It's a possibility. I think you just need to armor though. It's way too valuable. I might consider replaying the Acolyte as opposed to the Frothing right here. I like the Frothing more, but
okay. So just trying to get more card draw to extend your stay.
Yeah, makes sense. This is good. I like this a lot. You can just armor for the execute trade. It's a 1-1 against a Frothing. You're in a good position. This draw right here is really, really important for RDU. You need something good, like a high main, even a Shredder, a weapon would be okay.
Double Creeper, that's not what he wants to see.
Look at his face.
His face is telling a story.
Salt Blizz, so sad.
Although, honestly, like those 1-1s without a Whirlwind can't be cleared. So it looks ridiculous here, but RDU is going to be able to like wear down his opponent a little bit of damage at a time as long as Oskaka doesn't pick up a clear.
I think you just play that.
Yeah, play everything.
Play it. Play the Pain. Run it into a 1-2. The 1-2, that way you draw. And then just go face the Frothing and Armor. Because if you draw into a Patron, you win instantly. because the frothing will build up. I mean, the thing is, the amount of pressure RDU has is only 2, so that's not very much as opposed to like.
Well, it's countered by the hero power, basically. Like,
yeah.
There's if it was another class, you know, patron would of course, like the warrior, wouldn't live, but because you can just negate 2 damage every single turn, it's pretty easy. And this is what makes warriors so easy to navigate, I guess, against hunters, is that the inevitability of the hero power doesn't affect you as much. So you're really just fighting board against board. Not the best of pickups.
Not a very good draw either. Yeah. Wait, did he not? He ran that into face. He didn't draw there. That's interesting.
Yeah, he did not attack into the 1-2 creeper, which
probably would have tried to draw for like an armor smith or something. Maybe he'll draw right now, because if he gets a whirlwind, he's in a better position. Looks like
he gets a whirlwind. He's in heaven.
Or patron. Oh, that. You can run in. I might have liked him running in that. No, this is fine.
All right, so what do you pop, if anything? Because I mean, I'm guessing Battle Rage hits, right?
Yeah, you want to bounce back your Gnomish, I think. Well, he's going to Battle Rage, but what is he looking for? Is he looking to lethal this turn?
He's looking for the Whirlwind, most definitely.
Yeah, but like, would double Whirlwind be lethal or something? Because the way he's making these attacks makes it seem like.
Well, I think if he whirlwinds once, he's pushing a lot of damage. I think he's pushing like upwards of another, what, 16, 17?
So you can just get armor this turn.
So if you push for 10 here, and you're on 8 health.
I think
you have
to get armor. I think it's too risky to push.
So you have to attack into a minion with the armor smith, and then you push for 12.
Yeah, see, now he's doing this. He messed up, because now it's going to get frozen. I think, oh, he didn't attack. He ran out of time. That stinks. See if it bites him. Nope. Oh, RDU, so mad.
This is why you run Wolf Riders, ladies and gentlemen. Exactly. You can't smork with an Argent Squire. It improves your early game, but you can't get those mid-game pushes.
At least Elven Archer, man. I think, I mean, the whole point of this deck is to get bored early. And that's why it's running freezings and stuff like that. If it was a smork hunter, it'd be running explosives.
Explosives, of course.
But yeah. He was more concerned about like aggro paladin, maybe zoo, fighting for board early. So this deck isn't really meant to beat patron.
No, obviously not. And the thing is, RDU knows that he's in a really awful spot. The game is pretty much everything but lost at this point. With a board like this, a Skaka can navigate just flawlessly. Yeah, like, exactly. There's nothing here for him to lose to.
Well, kill command. That's really bad though. Like, he drew creeper into squire. Like, that's so bad.
Well, it happened to him yesterday. Like, I think Nihilim yesterday had the worst streak of draws I have ever seen. I guess it compensated for the first day of the phase 2, where they got like the perfect draws, or at least their opponents didn't get any good draws. But RD is going to be having to play that hunter again. Forsen Boys locks up the warrior from Oskaka.
Patron, yeah.
It's not really a big surprise. Usually you expect patron to eventually get a win, so getting it early, I guess, is as good as getting it late.
Exactly.
So it's just a matter of RD coming back.
It's not a heartbreaking loss, I would say, just because. Right. Like, the hunter's probably going to find a win. Patron Warrior was pretty much going to find a win against your lineup, I would say. So.
Yep. Also, if you guys want to tweet, #ATLC, any thoughts on the Archon Team Championships, feel free to do so. They'll show up on screen during the, you know, the lineup. We're going to be seeing your tweets. So, looking at this lineup, I don't really know if anybody has a clear edge, because, you know, there's no Warlock on the Hillim side. It's a class that was very prevalent early in ATLC and somehow started being phased out. I mean, if it was Warlock, it wasn't Handlock anymore, and it still hasn't come back at all.
Yeah, that's surprising to me. I would expect just Zoo to be really strong right now.
Yeah,
but I guess Forsen Boys don't generally bring Druid, so that's why they probably decided not to bring Zoo, and that's probably why they decided to bring Control Warrior. Control Warrior is, you know, countered by Druid, but it beats pretty much everything else. Zoo, pretty good against Druid, but they don't bring Druid, so it works out.
Yeah, so, I mean, you're trying to target Druid with Zoo. Is there anything else that you're really trying to counter? Because, I mean, Patron doesn't quite lose to it. It's one of the few aggro decks that will put pressure on Patron if they get a decent start. but it's not. I mean, okay, so here I have a question. What is actually, because we were talking with RDU yesterday about how Patron is able to keep aggro in check. You know, hyper aggressive decks, right? Like the hyper aggro hunter decks are being kept in check by Patron. But on the other hand, you have like tempo decks like Zoo that do very well against Patron. What is the best, you know, tempo aggro deck to counter Patron at the moment? From your perspective, of course.
Tempo aggro decks to counter Patron?
Yeah.
Probably like Mech Shaman, I guess. Okay. Does that count?
Yeah, it does. Yeah. It perfectly does. It does.
I would say that's probably the best, one of the best decks against Patron.
All right. Well, that's probably the what RDU was making a reference to, because it's a bit tricky, I find, to find the perfect counter to Patron, just because it keeps so many decks in check by the way it's designed.
I would say it more keeps Face Hunter in check, just because of all the like AoEs it runs, and you know it can gain easy armor through Armorsmith. Yeah, and Face Hunter is like a pretty strong deck, but if Patron's around, you're just gonna lose that matchup. So it looks like we have Paladin against Warlock, and Forsen is running Handlock or Zoo, probably Zoo, right?
Forsen, yeah, he was running his Zoo yesterday. Got a sick streak of games with his Zoo at the very end there. A little misplay was made yesterday against his opponent, but he still ended up winning. So lucky for him, he's going to have a chance to get to the live finale. Well, you know what? Forsen boys was on the cusp of elimination too. You know, I didn't mention that, but they are climbing back. This is, of course, a big game for both teams. But Forsen boys, if they can win this, they're going to feel pretty happy because they were very low on the standings at the end there.
Yeah, they were doing pretty well in the very beginning of the league, but something in the middle kind of went wrong for them. Might have been RNG, might have been deck choices, I really have no idea, but they started to fall off. They're climbing back, you know. If they win this, they're in the finals. It's just as good as being first or second in the league because you qualify. So it's really sick, especially against a team like Nihilim. Yeah.
So Zoo versus Paladin, the Paladin version from Life Coach we saw yesterday was running that Gadget Sand Jouster, the 1-mana 1/2 that hopes to win a joust to become a zombie chow. I we were really surprised by that inclusion, because even though you might win, let's assume you win 60% of the time, right? Like a really good and high estimate. Let's assume you run and you win most of the time. Is it ever worth it in control?
I think the idea behind it is the only time you really need a zombie chow like that is against aggro, and most of the time you're going to win the joust against aggro because they're running a low curve, and against control it doesn't heal them, so it's like better than the zombie chow in that aspect. Also, a thing not discussed too much is you actually reveal cards from your opponent's deck, so it's also how much you value that information, because you joust and you get to see a card, right? They get to see a card also, but maybe you don't care if they see your cards.
Maybe you're playing control Paladin, you think your deck is already predictable, but you want to know what you're up against. You know, if you pick up a Dreadsteed in that Warlock deck,
you know what's going down.
Yeah, you see that Doomsayer coming down, and then Dreadsteed following it up, and welcome to hell.
See a Twisting Nether.
Yeah, it's actually not too bad. Like if Varian Rin picks up, I wouldn't be surprised to see Twisting Nether make its appearance in a Warlock deck or another. Like control
with
Warlock.
You have two Dreadsteeds on board. Twisting Nether, Dreadsteeds stay alive.
Yeah.
It's beautiful.
You play the Spellslinger from your opponent, and then you can get an Ancestral Spirit, and then you can get like triple Dreadsteed.
Life Coach looks young.
Yeah, I think he lost the beard, didn't he?
Yeah, it's probably the stress.
All right, let's see how Forsen deals with the RNG today. You know, it really varies from day to day. Sometimes it's fine, sometimes it's much less fine. Oh, he's definitely on the snus right now. He needs to manage the stress.
This is a pretty good hand from Forsen. You generally want creepers, you want things that are... things that can deal with the musters if they have them, and Life Coach has a really good hand as well. Double muster into Consecrate, mini-bot. Even Aldor is fine. I really like Life Coach's hand. It's really, really strong. He didn't get the one drop, obviously, but mini bot, muster, consecrate. It's going to be really hard for Forsen.
I think the hand from Life Coach is like the what could change. Really good juggles. Very often that'll do it, and this is kind of why you need the muster, because if there's an implosion that comes up, that'll already set up. You're going to be punished for it really hard.
Turn one rope.
Yeah, because he's thinking, you know, if I coin mini bot, Do I want my musters faster? Do I want to keep coin for consecrate? On
yeah, he's considering like all the things. Like you have to plan like 3 or 4 turns in defense.
Forston is already tilting from the time it takes. He's like, you've got to be kidding me, man. This can't be real. This is beautiful.
I wonder Question's if you mini bot, you mini bot here. You can't play muster.
Muster is too weak, I think. I mean, yeah, if you go for muster, then your consecration is delayed and it still doesn't do much. So you really need to get some way to pop the creeper. And mini bot is probably the closest thing you've got when you follow it up with a muster for battle on turn 3.
God, Life Coach's hand is just sick, though. It's amazing. Really, really strong, yeah. Forson's got to learn to tab when he plays.
I mean, I don't know how people play Hearthstone without. If I don't have 5 other windows open, I can't play the game. Exactly. I don't know how people pull it off. I mean, it's crazy. Well, this is a pretty okay pickup for Forson. It's a high threat minion in this case. It's gonna set up a nice implosion too if your opponent goes for an implosion.
I think he's gonna abusive his. Oh wow, he's not gonna abusive. He's just gonna go face.
I thought it was going to abusive the
Voidwalker, and if it hit,
Voidwalker to hit,
and then
yeah,
go
exactly.
Face. Yeah, I'm not sure if that's even better than this play though. It's subjective.
I mean, this is definitely weaker to consecration.
Yeah,
but you've got
are you really scared of consecrate right now?
No, not so much. No, that's the thing. Like, it's weaker to consecration, but at the same time. If the consecration falls down now, then you have a better chance of establishing a future board. He's gonna go for the lucky jump.
Oh my god. This consecrate, okay. He's not gonna go all the way.
Well, consecration is still amazing, though.
Do you consecrate here? Do you muster? Consecrate clears all but one. The thing is, Forsen's kind of okay with a consecrate just because he has the implosion.
Yeah.
That's why he didn't pop the creeper.
I vote for muster.
I vote for muster as well.
All right. Motion goes through. We muster. No.
He might be scared of like an Argus, because one play plays around the implosion, the other plays around the Argus. This plays around the implosion. But the thing is, if the Argus is, I feel like you can just true soul, or you can consecrate as well and have the weapon to clear it.
Yeah, the muster for battle and the 1/1s and the consecration together should take care of a defensive Argus. But maybe he's afraid of taking too much damage in the process.
Yeah, you just have to
double implosion. Okay. The good thing here is it can't fail.
Oh,
nice job,
two implosion.
Oh, this is beautiful.
It's the karma for BMing.
Yeah, he got it from yesterday, man. That BM was... Well, then again, Firebat did go
That's
for
true.
It.
That's true. Yeah, you have to return the favor. Exactly. It was
I
justified.
Get the feeling Firebat was legitimately saying sorry, right? Like, I get that vibe. Whenever Firebat goes for the BM, I'm like, he's actually apologizing for a skill stone.
I don't know about that. Man, Life Coach's muster or implosion hit for 3 there. He got 3 little units.
Let's do it.
Three. That's okay. That's reasonable. Right. But this knife juggler into muster, Force is gonna be so mad. Oh my goodness.
Let's see it. Let's see it. Oh, and Tuskar Jouster just to seal up the health total to a very comfortable position. Forson thinks, oh, I'm gonna have 4 minions next turn, right? Like, they can play Gormok after top decking a 2-drop. Nope. Definitely not happening. Also, by the way, what do you think of Gormok? I thought the card was going to be super sick, but I haven't really been impressed by it so far trying it out. It's really hard to set up.
I thought it would be really bad, but it has gotten a little more use, man.
Okay, so you thought it was going to be worse, so you were impressed, and I thought the exact opposite.
I was a little
opposite.
More impressed, yeah.
Interesting.
Double quality in Life Coach's deck.
Horson's face is telling the story of his woes. That's an okay pickup, I guess. Aside from the fact that Aldor Peacekeeper deals with it, it's a pretty good pickup.
Yeah, Forson's not going to be too happy about this. I think True Silver might just be better here.
Poor Forson. Nothing's going to ride this game.
Man. And both implosions are gone, so you don't really have a very good comeback potential, because that's what, you know, like knife juggler implosion or something like that is usually how you get board back a zoo. But right now, the only thing he can really do is like hope for an egg or something to PO and to trading.
Yeah, and then you have to also top deck a few, like the Doomguard top decks could still help you come back in the game. From your perspective, of course, but when you see Life Coach's hand from, you know, the caster side, it's much easier to see that he won't really have too much trouble with it. Between Aldor, Equalities, and Health Restoration, usually he's going to be very comfortable no matter what hits. All right, so he's opting for the Aldor Peacekeeper play. He was hoping for a juggle there, I think, to get a good trade. Does he just trade into it because he doesn't want to see a Defendo Argus?
Might. I'm not sure. Looks like he's going to. To be fair, Life Coach's hand was like ridiculously good against Zoo. I don't think there was anything Forcing could have done. Maybe not rolled a 2 on that implosion. That would have helped.
Right.
Oh, man. Feels bad, man. Yeah.
Forsten just concedes. I mean, he knows at this point there's no way for him. Like, the whiplash mechanic's just not there, right? When implosion's gone, knife juggler implosion is one of the best ways to handle some kind of mid-game Silverhand Recruit heavy board, and that just was already gone, so.
Yeah, it's pretty unfortunate that he rolled the 2 there, and I don't know, he even set up for, like, a pretty good, like, bait consecrate into, like, where he could play the implosion, but he kind of got punished by Knife Juggler Muster. Muster into Knife Juggler Muster when your board is all 1/1s is kind of hard to deal with, I would say.
But it was a really good win for Life Coach, though, because his Paladin had a little bit of trouble when we saw it play yesterday. So it's nice to see that his Paladin is already out of the way. Nihilim must be feeling pretty good about this, because that Paladin wasn't exactly... I mean, that 1/2 that you mentioned had some potential against control. It really backfired hard yesterday. Like, it could have won the game against Druid had it been a Zombie Chow. It's kind of
actually
like
agree
a weird
that,
gamble.
That win was really important, the Paladin getting out. Because I feel like Hunter would beat it. I feel like Shaman would probably beat it. Aggro Paladin maybe beat it. You know, Freeze Mage is going to beat it.
Yeah, you're right. I think Aggro Pally... what do you think about Aggro Pally versus the control side of Paladin? Because they tend to both play the earlier... Like, they both play some of the early game, but the Paladin can stabilize maybe a bit better. It's just that if you're not running Wild Pyros, which just don't exist anymore in control Pally, even nowadays, it's really hard to get rid of all the Divine Shields. It's kind of like the Warrior Syndrome. Where
you just
only
need
weapons.
Muster, you need Knife Juggler, and you need Consecrated for the control Paladin, but... The Aggro Paladin, I don't know. The qualities aren't going to do anything if all your creatures are 1 HP anyways, and you can just smork them and try to get a Divine Favor. But that matchup won't be happening. I wonder what Nihilim will go with next. It's 1-1 right now.
Yeah, I mean, I'm hoping to see the Shaman from RDU eventually. It's one of the decks that we haven't really seen too much of, so... Seeing what he plays, he says he plays Mech Shaman with Tuskar Totemic. I wonder how... I mean, he seems to agree that that was the line of Shaman deck building at the moment that was the most consistent until we see new decks crop up. I wonder if they're working on... Because a lot of people are trying to make Shaman work that isn't Mech, right? Like trying to go back to the mid-range style, maybe a control style, something along those lines. And at the moment, nothing has quite come up that is... better than Mech Shaman, right? There's a lot of good variants with the Thunderblood Valiant, which is doing amazing.
Yeah.
But when you don't curve, that deck still falls behind a lot of the time.
Exactly. I think it's a decent deck. I would say it's about on par with Control Paladin.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, Life Coach
Tier 1.5, Tier 2, I guess.
Exactly.
Somewhere around those lines.
That's like a perfect rating for it, I would say. So we got this Hunter versus Hunter.
Yeah. And Argent Squire in the starting hand for RDU is definitely a good pickup against... in this matchup, it's going to help you get a 2-for-1 out of almost no investment. Really.
Yeah, with Glaive Zooka, that's ridiculous. Did he keep a Freezing Trap? That's interesting. Guess he wanted to freeze like a Mad Scientist or something. Because he's expecting a Coin Creeper or Coin Mad Scientist here. Huh. I would have never thought he would keep a Freezing Trap.
I mean, I guess if you're trying to race for damage, getting that tempo lead is basically going to snowball. Like, Freezing Trap is basically deal 4 damage to your opponent.
Exactly. I mean, yeah, that's what it's doing right now, right? Yeah, that's interesting. Huh.
Are you going to return the favor? That's what we have
the
to know right
freezing.
Now. You want to play that game?
I think play Zuka, and you're not too unhappy about your 1-1 getting frozen.
That's not a big investment. It's just that you're going to be face tanking that Leprenome, and that's 4 damage. Like, so far, this Leprenome has dealt 6, and that's a lot of damage output.
That's a good freezing trap. Wow, that's a very good top deck.
Yeah, I was going to say, Knife Juggler is kind of weak because of the fact... Oh, the punish.
Summon Misha? Nope.
Trade? Nope. Gold face?
And Chalky's good at Hunter.
Chalky's the best Hunter player I've ever seen. He always gets the Huffers. Although, it seemed like recently, the Huffer is to Hunters what Fiery War Axe is to the Warriors these days. Nobody misses their War Axe. Yeah, it's incredible. Yeah. In the tournament so far, it's been amazing.
I like this play from RDU. I might have liked the Creeper more than the Freezing Chop, but I guess he's anticipating the Shredder, which, I mean, Chalky has, so that's very good.
Yeah, but I think if Chalky knows that, he's going to definitely just drop the Juggler and the Abusive, hope to trigger the trap with the Abusive Sergeant, and then play maybe a Lotheb on curve. So that's going to be
pretty decent following.
Yeah, the weak part of this play, I guess, is the fact that you're not really getting any damage in this turn, but the fact that the opponent will be face tanking the Juggler is effectively giving you 3 damage if that's gonna happen. He's not face tanking it, he's gonna face tank the
Abusive because it's gonna instead. Get frozen anyways.
Right. That makes sense. I mean, you don't mind taking 2 instead of 3, since nobody's gonna replay a Juggler for 4 mana. Not anytime soon.
Really crazy. So he ended up doing that 1 extra damage anyways through the juggle, but
right.
This Lotheb is going to go uncontested. Oh, that's a really big pickup if he hits the juggle, because now he doesn't have to take 5. Lotheb was going to connect for 5 there almost like for sure, but
believe me, he's going to get a Wrathguard. Oh, the nightmare.
He needs to hit 1 juggle. There we go. All right, he's got it.
Here comes the Wrathguard. No, it's actually
Wraith Carp.
What a sick pickup. And RDU now sees a potential win. It looked everything but lost when you're so far behind on health in a raise situation. Wow, RDU is picking this up. Alright, not a bad card to find.
I think...
Do you make trades at all here, or do you just push?
I think you might want to smork.
I'm thinking when you're so far behind, you have to just hope it doesn't have.
You can kill the creeper so you can protect your divine shield, and I'm not opposed to that.
And then you prop the creeper on the shredder. Sorry, but then unleash becomes more punishing, right?
I don't know if I would do this. This is I'm not sure if Chalky's even running unleash, and I think RDU might know that.
Oh.
Yeah, that's a pretty good shredder job, I would say.
Chalky's really good at Hunter. I thought he was just good, but he's really good.
Is he running explosive? If he's running explosive, that's like insane. I don't know. I feel like that was a lot of wasted damage.
Well, if he runs explosive, in this case, it might let 3 minions live, right?
Ooh,
oh,
freezing.
That's.
I think they're running very similar lists.
Looks like it. Freezing, like smork.
Hybrid without. High mains or something? I don't think I've seen a high main. Maybe Chalky has one.
I haven't seen it so far, so there's a good chance that neither player plays it. I mean, it's the type of card that really curves the deck up, and the Argent's Choirs give you that extra trading potential, and in a metagame that's riddled with Divine Shield Paladin, the aggro value list, I think there's a good argument to be made for not for running the Squires. Because the high mains basically do nothing, right? It's like, you're already dead by the time it comes out. Wow. All right. Pretty convincing.
The juggle here.
There we go. Nice job.
Yeah. I if you know he's not running Unleashed, that trade's fine. And it looks like RDU does. Because, I mean, they've played, over 3 games each with their decks, at least.
Yeah.
So they should know the decks card for card.
Not what Chalky was looking for, and I think this is a lost game for him at this point.
Is there enough damage on board?
He can't kill Leok. That's for sure.
Yeah.
that alone is enough to be a problem, because even if you kill the juggler and you kill the Inoyotron and you hit hero power for 2, how do you find an extra 14 damage or 11 since you have the bow? Like 11 from a single top deck? That's looking very unlikely. Maybe like quick shot into quick shot.
Yeah, no, there's like no way, I don't think.
So he's just going to have to smork at the face and hope he picks up the unleash.
Yeah, I don't even think he runs unleash. I think he's just hoping to top deck like double quick shot into like Leroy or something. I mean, it's not unreasonable. He just needs one quick shot into an arcane golem or something. So he's playing Dispel. This is going to seal the game regardless, because if it's a taunt, it's like enough, right?
Yeah. Leok and Huffer were guaranteed lethal. I think he still has it though, or maybe he's just like one off. He's going to be one off. Wow. Interesting. And now even Unleash doesn't do it.
Yeah,
that was a really well piloted deck by like the piloted game by RDU. I thought like the line of play that we saw with the freezing trap, where he decided to coin it out to regain the
tempo. That was Chalky, I believe. Chalky played the freezing trap. He kept it in his opening hand. He had Leprechaun freezing trap.
No. That was
the coin. Yeah. Okay. Yeah the second one. Yeah. Okay. Instead of playing the creeper,
yes.
to prevent the shredder. That was a good play. I agree. That was interesting. A lot of people would have played Creeper there, and then the guy would have played Shredder, and then he would have just lost, probably. So, good play. Yeah. I agree.
It's not every day that I find a Hunter Mirror match super interesting. I'll be honest with you, it's one of the matches that I... Like, Hunter Mirror match is interesting. Hunter matches I find sometimes a little dull on the hyper-aggressive side, because you kind of see everything kind of snowball. But I thought RDU was lost for sure there. I thought for the most part that was game. But the Inoyotron is, again... his saving grace, right? Like, there's only, one other taunt? Two other taunts, Frostwolf Grunt and Unstable Ghoul. Unstable Ghoul would have wrecked his board, which would have been a problem. And the Frostwolf Grunt would have done very little in the face of, repeated damage input, so...
Yeah, I think it was that Knife Juggler to pick up on the Lotheb turn. He had no way to deal with Lotheb. He was at, 17 HP, picked up a Knife Juggler, and then he, just traded in his Shredder and was able to kill the Lotheb. Yeah. Which is really important. Otherwise, he would have been at, 12 plus hero power 10. He would have been dead in, a few turns. And the Inoyotron coupled with that is pretty insane.
Yeah, so Shaki may always get the Huffers, but RDU gets the good Shredders. I guess that ends up mattering a bit more. There's a Druid on Thais' side. Darnassus Aspirant. We've been talking about this a bit. I know you're a big Druid aficionado from back in the days. How excited are you to play Druid going forward in TGT?
I don't like it.
You don't like it anymore? That's
it? I don't like it anymore. I'm done with that class.
Okay, that's it. You're just going to be playing Rogue for the rest of your days?
Exactly.
All right.
I don't know. Darnassus Aspirant or whatever. I don't even know how to pronounce it. I don't think it's as good as most people are leading on. Wild Growth seems just straight up better. It almost always dies on turn 2, and if you're fighting for board, it's only a 2-3, so I don't know. I'd much rather have a Wild Growth in many cases. You can run it as another ramp card, I would say, but I'm not sure how much I like it as just a
replacement. So you're not sure how good it is to have 4 Wild Growths in your deck.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
It's maybe just a bit too much. So just 2 Wild Growths would be more than enough to ramp. Yeah. All right, that's interesting. That's probably the first dissenting opinion I've heard.
Yeah, 2 Wild Growths and a Darnassus is probably one of the better ways to go about it. So Warrior versus Hunter. And this is Control Warrior with Zombie Chow, right?
Right. That's the most anti-aggro tech Warrior I think I've seen in a long time. There's no Alex, no Grom. It's even more defensive than you might think. There's an Ysera, which is very slow, so I guess ultimately it's not necessarily a good card to have, because you can't burst the Hunter down at the end of the game, but you should be able to stabilize for a very long time. I know he's running 1 Bash, which is an incredible card, I think, in Control Warrior, especially if you're trying to target those mid-range aggressive decks, and I think Hunter from Shock, he's going to suffer from that Bash sometime during the game.
Yeah, it's going to come down to early draws for Life Coach, so he can definitely whiff, and Chalky can take the board early and just do too much damage to him, but we'll see. He's running Bash also, that's right. Oh my goodness.
I love the Bash. There's no way you're throwing that back if you're Life Coach, knowing what Shalky's playing. It's such a... So, a lot of people didn't really like that card too much at first, but I think after you've played it once or twice, you actually fall in love with it. Because it's reaching... it's basically your safeguard Fire War Axe. If things go super wrong, you can still kill that minion and recover the health, so you're creating a 6 health differential, sometimes 9, because of repeated damage potential. Pretty strong card.
So, do you play Coin Scientist here?
And Juggler is weak to War Axe. Yeah, I was going to say, you have to bait the War Axe hit with Mad
Scientist. He figures if he has War Axe, he has to play the 2-drop into 2-drop anyways. But this just allows him from like going Mad Scientist into maybe drawing a Creeper.
Life Coach picks up the second Armor Smith, so that's pretty solid. If you're looking at this from a defensive perspective, I don't think Life Coach can actually lose enough health to be threatened anytime soon. Like, there's no Iron Bical in Shocky's hand. Pretty the bow is gonna be great here though. Like, that's the closest to a great pickup as he could have had. He's gonna get himself like another freezing trap. Wow. Zombie Chow!
Job's done.
Alright.
Life Coach has one of the better hands that I've seen, I think. Against a situation where you're trying to control the board against some type of aggressive deck. But Shocky picked up the bow, so that's going to allow him to get back on the board in some way.
That bow is a really important pickup. I don't expect Life Coach to be attacking into that anytime soon. Like proccing the trap anytime soon. Might as well just play this like an Armor Smith, armor up. Have a good time with your armor gain on the board.
What now?
Do you just play Armor Smith, Hero Power, and get even more armor out of the future turns?
I think
you have
debating,
a Bellatrix to go through. Go ahead.
He's debating whether or not to play the Deathbite or the Armor Smith. Because he wants to contest the board quickly and then just like get it. So, you know, he only has to play Chargers. But yeah, Armor Smith's good because next turn you're going to be playing the Belcher. And it's going to be hard to deal with that Belcher without giving him like a ton of armor.
Yeah. Does Shocky have the Iron Beaks here? I mean, I think I've seen them yesterday, so he definitely runs those. I mean, you couldn't possibly run some kind of hybrid Hunter deck without Iron Beaks, I think. It's suicide. For the most part, at least. Not the best of draws. Not the best of draws for Life Coach. But
yeah. I mean,
might come
in
handy
later.
He's in a
pretty good position. You just play the Belcher. He's scared of a silence. That's the only thing that really counters your Belcher. But if Chalky doesn't have the silence, like, how does he deal with this board? I don't think he can. So, yeah,
never trigger the trap, never give him an extra charge, and just wait this game out. There's no way you can fall behind on health for the time being.
This is rough for Chalky. You can proc the trap next turn if you want to and start clearing the board. But you don't do it until you can start making plays that benefit you. As opposed to, you know, just proccing it, giving an extra charge, taking away from your armorsness.
I mean, if he finds a Doomsayer off of the Shredder, he could pull it off. Because you'd have to attack into the Belcher with the Shredder and with the Abusive Sergeant, then you pop the Slime with the 3-1, and if he doesn't have an Execute...
It's true.
That would help. Oh man, Shocky's just doing
all
it.
In.
Flood the board and hope something sticks. It's like throwing spaghetti on the wall.
Right, throwing spaghetti on the wall.
Throwing spaghetti on the wall and hope it sticks. You've never done that, have you? My childhood was full of amazing memories.
You're just throwing spaghetti on the ceiling.
Yeah, that's it, and hope it sticks.
Oh man.
Not very dangerous, but it's fun. Wonderful. Pretty much what Chalky's doing here. So we'll see if Life Coach opts to develop the Dead's Bite here. I'd imagine he will, right? I mean, it's kind of a time to trigger the trap, if ever.
I don't think you have to trigger the trap, but you can use the Death's Bite right now and armor up.
Okay.
And then next turn you'll get the Whirlwind effect from both Armor Smiths. It'll be a good time.
What now?
Yeah. And then Chalky will be upset.
That makes sense. I mean, your turn 7 is still pretty sweet anyway, because you can even re-equip the Death Bite if you want.
Oh, he's proccing the trap. Interesting.
And here we go. Will he replay this? There's a good reason to. I mean, there's no reason. Why would you not at this point?
You just get so much armor for each attack that happens.
Yeah, you even initiate the trades. Not Bagel.
Bagel. Ooh, this draw is gonna be really important.
Let's see if Bagel draws.
Got it.
It does. Wow, crazy good. Iron Beak. Oh, hello. A little late to the party, mate,
I think it's pretty late.
Yeah. I mean, you can go for a Iron Beak Owl on the Belcher, Freezing Trap, and kill one of the Armorsmiths with the bow. And then quick shot the Belcher if you want. It's all kind of weird, but...
I don't even know how you navigate this turn.
The Belcher and kill with the Creeper, right?
You can Iron Beak Owl the 1/4 Armorsmith if you want. Oh.
I kind of like the whole Freezing Trap, the second Armorsmith plan.
Yeah, I agree. If he does this, he needs to attack.
You get a hero power too.
First. Yeah, you're right. This is good.
Shocky. Suddenly confused. I was smorking. What's wrong? Oh, wow. Nat Bagel is going to get in for some action. Never thought I'd see that. All right, so that's a pretty good play here from Shocky. I'm liking this.
Remember the old Miracle Road days when they ran Bagel?
Yeah, and it was so broken.
You could cold blood it. It was like a combo. It was like a legit combo. So funny.
That big old early game into cold blood. You're like, really, really? This is happening to me. I've got nothing but a war axe. What do I do?
4/4 that draws so much value.
At the end of the turn too.
Exactly. So I don't think you want to feed this bow anymore. Yeah. I think you want to get out the Dust Bite. The question is, do you want to play the Pain?
I'd probably just play the Pain here. Yeah. Because next turn you can... I mean, it's such a good situation for a Life Coach because his Death Bite will kill literally everything and net him some armor on the back end. This is probably the only answer to a massive board like this in Control Warrior, because unlike Patron, they don't run Whirlwinds anymore. Some older variants used to.
Wow, that's a lot of damage.
You just push it? Because, I mean, it looks like a lot, but if you really think about it...
The Armorsmith becomes kind of scary. If you kill the Armorsmith in one fell swoop, it's more damage, I think. Actually, yeah. With the kill command.
So you deal 5 to the Armorsmith, overkill by 1.
And go face?
But I think it's still... Okay. I mean, could you ever quick shot the Armorsmith and trade a 1/1 into it?
Isn't that the same amount of damage, or is it less?
You're not overkilling, but I mean, you're losing the recurrent damage on the 1/1 that you think you were going to lose anyway from the Death Bite.
Sure.
Oh, Shocky smorks it. All right, let's do it.
I don't mind.
We've seen one Belcher, and he's going to push for damage and hope it works out. In this case, unfortunately for him, Life Coach should be able to stabilize. That's a lot of burst.
So much damage there. He's wondering if he should attack in, based on. If he draws another weapon, or if he needs the attack. It looks like he determines he needs the attack. This bash is going to be pretty big also. So, do you play the Cruel Taskmaster just for the armor that it gives? Or do you play the Sylvanas right now just for the armor it gives, and then armor up and then go face, and then next turn you have bash and Cruel Taskmaster?
I like the idea of Cruel Task.
Because Cruel Task would effectively give you one extra armor.
Yeah, exactly.
Because it's an extra body on the board and the one damage.
So I mean, you could even play Sylvanas and Cruel Task. It's the same as getting armor up, basically, in this case. And
but
you
it's
get
worse against Unleash, but there's no Unleash. I like Sylvanas because it fights for board against a Shredder. And then there's almost no chance you die this turn, I think. I think there's no chance you die.
3, 4, 5. He needs to find 10 damage.
Leroy is not lethal.
Leroy Arcane Golem would kill you, actually.
No, because you can't hear power.
No, but Leroy, that's 10, and you've got 3 from the bow. Oh, yeah, you're right. You can't hear power. Never mind. That's not 5. What is math? I don't know what math is. I don't play Patron. I don't do math.
Patron. So, this is Chalky's second time in a row. If he loses here, he's actually benched.
Yeah, and that's going to give Nihilim a good chance to isolate other decks, because they're already up. If they win this, they're going to be up 3-1 with the edge on the benching rule, and that's going to give them the ability to just pilot every other deck almost optimally for the matchups.
Yeah.
And God, look at the amount of armor, man. Oh. Yeah, I think you might even bash your own Sylvanas, then Cruel Tasker to take that Worgen, just to spite Shocky. Oh,
gosh.
Is that the play? Is that the play?
This is ridiculous. How is a Hunter supposed to win against Bash? Armor's cheating, man.
So first taunt is cheating, now armor is cheating. I think it's about time we get a card, and I mean that. Like, it's about time we get a card that does something to armor, though. I think we need some form of armor removal tool.
I can see that. They have
like a minion that removes armor or something, because
sometimes
it gets a little out of hand, to put
it
mildly.
It really does.
Right? Like 60 armor over 30 health. You're like, I didn't even play this game. Like, this guy just stacked up everything.
I mean, they have a hate card for demons, right?
Yeah, so they even made that one to silence demons. Right, good point.
So why wouldn't they have one for armor?
I mean, sure, the problem with that is that it seems like it's only affecting warriors. I mean, there's Ice Barrier that counts, and it's basically an anti-warrior card at that point. It's not even... Like, who do you give it to? Just hunters or neutrals? Right? Because, like, who cares about removing that armor?
Give it to hunters.
Going piercing shot, remove all armor, deal 5 damage.
See, you can even name it. That sounds awesome.
Let's do this. Imagine the hate Blizzard gets when they made that card, though. I can already see the uprising on Reddit.
Warriors at a pretty good position right now, like the class itself. I think it deserves the hate.
Yeah, no, I would tend to agree. They've got two really viable archetypes at the moment.
God, Bash is just like, I'd be so mad if
cheating,
I saw...
It's such a cheat.
I know, I'd be so mad if I saw Bash against me when I'm playing Hunter. Like, shield block, you're like, okay, like, I can understand that. I anticipated the shield block. Then Bash comes out. It's like, why am I even playing this game?
Shield block, Bash. Come on, Life Coach, you gotta show the Bash. You can't not Bash, if only for style points. Life Coach is not too much about style, though. He's very much about optimized plays down to the very last one, no matter what. What I find fascinating is his ability to talk to himself for a long period of time and still stay sane.
Who said he's still sane?
That's right, last time I was casting him, there was this mad scientist look about him. Like, the hair and everything was...
what is he doing? He's, like, going in. Oh, he's putting in, like, he's trying to lethal him.
Yeah, he's got lethal next turn.
That was an interesting play, wow.
I like it.
I mean, he has lethal next turn anyways with the Cruel Taskmasters on board, right?
Right, exactly. Oh, just having the damage dealing. All right, well, Life Coach picks up a win for his team, so the Warriors locked out. Life Coach doesn't quite get, the play again today because he's got his check mark, which is pretty sweet. RDU and Thais will have to get their wins on the back of this. Now, Force and Boys, I believe Shocky's benched, unless I'm mistaken. He just won twice in a row against Nihilum. Yeah. So that's going to be a bit rough. That's going to be a bit rough. Forsen, we know, has one deck left in Oskaka. Two decks left in Oskaka has one. So they're going to be carrying the team, basically.
Well, they're going to get targeted pretty hard. So Chalky's, I think, is benched. So Freeze Mage, Zoo, and Mech. And you have Druid, Mage, and Shaman.
All right, so what are you hoping for at this point? If you're Nihilum, what are you targeting?
Yeah,
there's a Freeze Mage, right? What do you do about the Freeze Mage? You just queue Druid into it? But what if you face off against Zoo and Shaman
are too good against Druid, I would feel like.
Yeah.
Everything's pretty good against Druid. They could just sweep Druid, honestly. But I would probably go for the Shaman or the Mage if I was on Nihilum.
So I guess the Mage is a coin flip against Forsen's Mage. Against Zoo, you have the edge, and against Mech Shaman, you can hold your own depending on how good your early game is. It's just that Mech Shaman can get crazy blowouts against Freeze Mage sometimes, right? Like, they don't let you secret up, and then the game is over.
I wouldn't be opposed to Freeze Mage, but Freeze Mage is pretty good against whatever Chalky has also, right? It's good against Base Hunter, Paladin. Maybe you just queue Mage and be happy with it.
Yeah, it doesn't look too bad. I mean, you're probably having, like, you have an edge over... It all depends on whether or not Thais thinks he's got the edge in the mirror match, right? Like, you're a very experienced Freeze Mage player, I think. Like, I've seen you play a lot, and you seem to know your Freeze Mage. Yeah. Thais is another one of those players that I rate very highly on the Freeze Mage scale. Forsen's been playing the deck since the beginning of Hearthstone, I think, pretty much at this stage. So they're both, if they go up against each other, I think it's going to be a pretty interesting
good match. We have Mage versus Shaman, and this is Mech Shaman, right?
Yeah, it is the Mech Shaman from Oskaka. We saw him piloted. Oskaka has a very nice playstyle with Mech Shaman. He's much more conservative than myself, at the very least, and most players that I've seen play it. He goes all in much less frequently. He makes trades for much longer than I'd expect, and that's put him in a lot of better positions than I ever thought he could be in. So he's definitely a competent player of the class and the archetype.
A lot of this comes down to the very, very early draws, like usual, of course. Because sometimes the Shaman can just like have a Whirling Zap-O-Matic, and the Mage doesn't have a Frostbolt, so you know you have no way to deal with that until you can like Fireball the Whirling Zap-O-Matic, and by that time you've taken so much damage. So it really comes down to the Shaman's early draws, and if they're running like Doomhammer for like, you know, the 16 damage throughout the game, things like that.
Yeah, and I think the Frostbolt is an auto keep just because Zap-O-Matic is such a big threat. Like, there's no way you can afford not keeping it. And Oskaka's got an okay hand. I mean, there only is one drop in that deck at the moment, which is the Cogmaster. And you're pretty much, if you're first off the coin, you pretty much rely on it to get you started a little bit.
Yeah. I like that keep from Thais. That's exactly what I would have done. And there's the Doomhammer. That card is really, really important in this matchup. That represents 16 damage, at least, excluding the Rockbiters.
Yeah, we made a comparison yesterday about it. You know, I was talking to RDU and I was like, this is basically like playing Doomhammer against Control Warrior. And he said, yeah, but now you don't even have Harrison Jones, so it's guaranteed to be 16 damage. And I'm like, yeah, I mean, you can't argue with the facts. That card is just completely insane in the matchup.
Exactly.
Like, it counters the two Ice Barriers in a single card. Ugh, I hate this position. I mean, I guess... Maybe you go for the Earth Shock and curve Power Mace next turn into turn 4 mech.
That's what I'm thinking.
Or is that not worth it?
You could go with the Mech Warper and go face, but if he kills your Mech Warper with a ping, then you don't have another mech to combo your Cogmaster with, so it's kind of irrelevant. I think you might want to save the Earth Shock for maybe like a Doomsayer. Maybe that's what he's seeking, or maybe a Mad Scientist even. So I don't expect the Earth Shock. I'm just wondering if he's going to trade. Looks like he is going for the shock. Interesting.
So I have to assume it's either going to be a hope for two drop mech, which would put him pretty far ahead on board, or develop the Power Mace and set up a turn four play with his own mechs. That would be my expectation at this point. Easy. Cycle with Thalnos.
Yeah, I like it. You don't want a Frostbolt to 1-2. Even if it's a 3-2, you're more concerned about a Whirling Zap-O-Matic or something like that. Lava Burst.
All right, so going, it's kind of going according to plan in a way.
Yeah, he was going hoping for Thais, though.
Yeah.
Playing off curve the last two turns doesn't feel very good.
That's a great card for Thais to find.
Yeah, next turn he can play it. This turn, not so much.
I mean, he's got answers to Zap-O-Matic no matter what, basically. Like, the only time where he doesn't kill it outright is when he's used up the Fireball and the Power Mace hits. On the Zap-O-Matic, for instance.
Yeah, this turn's interesting. I'm not sure if he would run in the Thalnos and just ping this turn. I don't really like
on the Mech Warper.
Yeah, the Frostbolt, I mean, you can do that. That's fine as well.
I can see what you mean, though, because committing the Frostbolt here means if something else comes up next turn, then you're forced to use premium removal or AoE removal on, like, very few targets, for instance.
Yeah, that's a lot of
weapons. That's a lot of weapons to the face. The thing is, if you calculate all the damage he's got here, he's basically holding lethal just off of weapons and the Lava Burst. So all he has to do is hit face every turn.
That's 16 plus 12. Plus
Lava Burst. Yeah, he just pushes.
It's a lot of damage.
It's a lot of turns, too, which is the problem.
It's a lot of turns.
That's the biggest issue I think you're running into here, is you have to push face every turn. But the interesting thing is the power maces, because they're going to be spaced out, will probably allow you to find a mech before you trigger the death rattle. So you should be able to find enough time to get something to use them on and benefit from the death rattle effect.
Is Oskaka running Fell Reavers? Do you know?
I haven't seen them, though. I think there's Fireguard Destroyers in there.
Ooh, those are pretty good.
Yeah.
So much burst. Like, do you have to go for the Doomhammer now? Like, attack in, play a Doomhammer, and attack into the Thalnos, and then go face? Just to develop it? You can start, like, Lava Bursting now if you want. Like, go for Totem and Lava Burst, but I don't know.
So if you Lava Burst this turn, then you're expecting to Power Mace again next turn, right? You're not putting out the Doomhammer, right?
I like the Doomhammer. And then he has to attack again. Now. Yeah.
Yeah.
It looks like it's gonna go face, yeah. Perfect.
This is devastating. Like, the amount of damage Thais is taking, and there's no board to respond to. That's the worst case scenario, because you can't answer a board
exactly.
Already. Well, you can't answer weapons unless you start freezing face every turn.
Wasn't somebody running double heal bot last night or something?
Yes, somebody was. I don't know what. I think that was Thais with the double heal bot. I think so.
If it was, that's pretty good in this matchup.
Yeah, I'm not even sure Thais is running Pyroblast. Maybe that's the cut.
This is I would say Thais is really ahead right now.
I mean, maybe it was Firebat running the double healbot. You make me second guess myself. I've seen so much Freeze Mage in ATLC, and it's been really great because I'm happy to see more Freeze Mage and less Tempo Mage. I find Freeze Mage to be one of the most interesting decks to pilot. I should stop saying pilot, I should say play instead. You know, it's just kind of an unnecessary synonym. I'm happy to see more Freeze Mage played, I guess. It's probably my favorite deck. That's competitive, of course.
Yeah. It's like playing solitaire. It's fun.
yeah, but that's the thing. Like, you're playing against yourself and how well you're able to plan your turns. And I guess sometimes you're playing against your secrets because they just don't want to come out on time, and then you're scrambling to get them out. So
Doomsayer here. Looks like he just wants board.
Is he dead? No.
Is he dead? I don't think Rockbiter maybe? How much is that?
Yeah, Rockbiter weapon would be like lethal, I think. That would be like way, way over lethal.
I think you need to just expend a Lava Burst now in case you draw into more burn. But you might want to be saving it for like post Alexstrasza or something like that.
And this Doomhammer is putting in a lot of work. You start being a bit worried at this point, don't you?
So goofy, yeah. And you need to draw into heal, or you need to draw into Alex. I mean, Alex is kind of healed, but Alex to be aggressive.
Yeah, I mean, you've got Frostbolt Icelands. I mean, worst case scenario, Thais can use those as...
Oh my goodness.
That's going to pop the first block.
At one. Sure. You can pop the block at one, right? Because you Rockbiter in, you Lava Burst, and then you Crackle.
Yeah, wow. That's popping it. And good luck, Thais. You're going to have to start freezing face or hope nothing gets top decked ever again.
Well, if he is the one running double heal bot, the odds of him drawing into a heal bot or a barrier or even I guess barrier wouldn't save him.
Second ice block even.
Oh, yeah, second ice block are pretty high. Except he can't play Alexstrasza this turn, so it's actually really, really good for Oskaka.
Yep, and you have one charge left on your Doomhammer to guarantee a kill if nothing gets picked up by Thais.
But he can.
Based
on
the luck, it's possible.
It's more Thais or Oskaka has to top deck something. Oh my goodness, and there's the heal bot.
All right, Thais is, you can see him sigh here, a breath of relief, or rather fill up his cheeks with air in relief. I'm not exactly sure what that was, but it was definitely relief, I could see.
I guess you have to draw here, because you don't have enough you could freeze phase for the next like four turns, or like not four turns, but you know, for two turns, right. And then maybe draw into another freeze. So like three turns to prevent.
Sounds about right now.
Yeah, exactly.
With that that ice lance.
You might be scared of dying. I guess. Yeah, it looks like he is. So he's just gonna freeze phase for the next like three turns.
It buys him so much time. Unless Osaka picks up an Earth Shock here to kill, to deny the draw. And even that's really weak, because what if he's already holding Alexstrasza? There's a lot of things that could go wrong from Osaka's perspective, so you don't really want to commit either way. And the fact that you're relying on weapons to get the lethal and your top deck spells, you're afraid that Thais just picks up some of his late game to stay alive, and then...
You're hoping for like, a Manatide here?
Yeah, probably. I'd assume Manatide. It was picked up yesterday, I think, by Osaka. That was definitely a good... good totem to find. What are your thoughts on Tuskar Totemic, by the way?
I haven't played it enough to really develop anything too solid on it. But I think it's good. It seems like, on average, you get a pretty good totem. And, I mean, if you're hero pairing most of the time anyways, a shaman, why not just like have a card that combines it? So I don't mind it. Obviously, it's bad when you're behind on board, but you just have to curve your deck a little lower. Flamestrike. Looks like he's going to draw here. I might draw first. I don't know, because he might freeze face, right?
Yeah, again, the same situation he was in earlier, but I would consider a Frost Nova to ping my Acolyte and then a freeze face, because the draw from the Acolyte is probably good enough.
If he's running double heal bot, yeah. But you're pushing a lot of damage by Flamestrike. Or not a lot, but you're pushing a decent amount.
You're right.
Yeah, because your unit's actually getting a good face. So he is setting up for lethal, kind of? Not this turn, but the turn after.
Huh. In a few turns, yeah. The Inoga Shrine is going to be... Like, you almost don't want to play it because the Acolyte gets the draw off of it. If it comes down to the fact that Osaka has to defend against minions... from Thais, that's going to be pretty amusing. Turn of the tables.
Yeah, I actually really like the hold from the Inoyotron last turn from Osaka. Because it doesn't get flame strikes. The guy didn't get a free draw. Now I think he's going to be more inclined to play it. Just because there's already a 1-1 on the board. And this will protect his 3-4. So... I should see a Frost Nova here. Oh, there,
and
he is running
second heal bot.
All right.
There we go.
No,
Thais,
no, yeah.
That's a safe.
Exactly. He doesn't have to freeze face every turn now, which is really nice. But he can freeze the board here. So like Healbot, trade in, Frost Nova, ping the 1-1.
So I have to ask, like, I haven't seen the second Ice Barrier, right? He's only played one. Has he cut one for another Healbot? I'd be very surprised.
That's true.
Because that's the kind of one, like, it's a modification you could make. I mean, in one way, it makes your mad scientist more consistent in getting ice block in a weird way. I'm not sure.
Yeah, it makes your mad scientist a little worse.
Overall,
but again, I'm not sure how to feel about it. I'm not sure. He might be running both. But then again, that might not be enough card draw to sustain.
So look at this damage, man. The heal bots are a lot of bursts. it's ridiculous to say so. It's like 6 damage out of your heal bots. He's winning because of those things. Little mechs just adding up. Heal bot, more like kill bot.
So, he has a lava burst to stay alive, right? 6 on board, 6 plus 12 is a number that's dead.
Would you do it, though?
No. Because you don't win if you lava burst one of those regardless. So you just assume he doesn't have the double fireball.
And that is going to be it. Thais is going to be able to seal the game, and that's going to give Nihilim a lead. 4-1 over Force and Boys. Osaka, if he plays again, could be benched and forced into play.
Dang.
Not exactly something you wanna be forced into.
Well, at that point, it doesn't really matter because they have to beat all decks with every other deck, so matchups wouldn't matter. but it would be a little embarrassing, maybe.
Like the triple bench. You bench the Skaka and then you bench Forsen at the end just to rub it in. We'll have to see if they're able to do it. I mean, Thais and RDU are lacking one deck each to win with for the check mark. Skaka's got his Shaman deck to play, and Forsen has, you know, his Zoom. Warlock and Freeze Mage, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. That's right.
What are you queuing to this if you Nihil him?
I would probably just go with the Shaman.
Okay.
And then just give Druid like so many opportunities. You might be expecting Forsen to play a Freeze Mage this one, because you know they'll be like, oh, like maybe they'll play Shaman, so you know, we'll mind game them into playing the
Mage, they don't want to get benched. You have to play into so you play Druid then, right?
I mean, because you might expect a Freeze Mage. Because, you know, the obvious thing is to play the Shaman. So it goes down to a little mind game thing. It's, I don't
it's
know.
It's a coin flip almost at this point. Like, you're almost just coin flipping, sending whichever comes out. Because it's all about, like, the value of benching Oskaka is so small either way at this point. Because if you bench Oskaka with, say, like, let's assume you go Shaman or Druid and you end up winning against Oskaka, then you still have to face off against Freeze Mage or Zoo with your Shaman if you're RDU. So, I mean, I don't even know how you're supposed to win against a Zoo player as Mech Shaman unless you have a sicker start than they do, and good luck with that, right? So it's a coin flip at this rate.
I mean, Mech Shaman can beat Freeze Mage as well, so it's not like an auto loss. Maybe you're not comfortable with Mech Shaman against Zoo, though.
Yeah, maybe that's the big drawback, is as soon as one of the players from Force and Boys ends up getting a win, then they unbench Shaki, which opens up, you know, a huge array of possibilities for, you know, deck choice. So Thais versus Forsen, we'll have the Druid and Warlock matchup, one that is considered awful for the Druid, but when you have a hand like this...
You just keep that hand, I think.
Yeah, you don't move anything out of this. That's it. That there's nothing to throw away.
Exactly. RNG just shined on you. Don't insult it by moving anything.
Oh, that's another improvement. So do you innervate the shade here just to get get it growing as soon as possible and then curve into growth?
Yeah, because your next turn is set anyways, and you might as well just get the shade out to deal with early threats or to start growing, something like that.
Yeah, Thais plays so much Druid that I'd be surprised if he didn't do it. It seems to me like a near guaranteed play. I guess the only argument is maybe next turn I'll want to Wild Growth, Innervate Wrath, but you can always Wrath and delay the Wild Growth by one turn.
Exactly.
If everything comes to that.
It's just
and Forsen is mad at the rope. His face when Thais took his time. All right, play the juggles.
Put this apple on your head.
So do you delay? I mean, if I top deck a keeper, I'm playing Wild Growth. If I don't, I might consider Wrathing here. Oh.
Just play that.
Yeah, never mind. Put a body on the board, maybe ramp if he doesn't want to trade. If he doesn't trade, then that's his loss.
Then, exactly. Then you get a Wild Growth and you get a Wrath. And there's no like real answer to it, I would say.
What could be played in Forsen's deck that would deal with this? I mean, there's not even a combination of... Like, there's no Dark Bomb, you know that for a fact, having seen his entire decklist. There's no, like, crazy direct damage. No amount of juggles will do this. Unless he goes, like, double Wisp into double one drop, but that's not happening either.
Double Wisp into double one drop.
Oh, man, the double Wisp, double target dummy opener. So Thais doesn't play the Aspirant. All right, so he wants to guarantee to keep the body.
That's what I was talking about. People value Wild Growth more than Aspirant most of the time. And next turn, he's setting up for next turn as well, because this turn he can end up going Wrath into Aspirant. Maybe Living Roots is better.
Than Wrath? Probably, but, yeah. If you're looking to deal damage, but the 1-1s are so useful against a Zoo player sometimes, you might consider them.
Well, you're not doing it for the 1-1s, you're doing it for the 2 damage on the
two damage, sorry, yeah.
Yeah. And you might want the cycle on the Wrath, but you also might want the tempo from the 1-mana thing. It just depends, because at this point you're kind of out of steam already, and if you draw another Innervate or something, you're done. Can't come back because you don't have any damage. So it looks like he's going to opt to play the Living Roots, that way he has the option to cycle.
That's the big drawback of a ramp, like of any deck that runs ramp for Druid, which is basically all of them, because once you've used up, if you get a really good ramp hand, if your follow-ups are terrible, like if you get just spells that do nothing, you're going to do nothing with that hand.
Oh, P.O.
Wow, Forsen's going to use P.O. to guarantee a kill on the Aspirant because he doesn't want to see a 6 drop.
That hand's actually not terrible. You have double Voidcaller into like Doomguard, so it's really hard for the Druid to deal with. It just depends what Tice talks into. And that's, yeah, that's...
that's pretty good. I'd say that's just about good. You saw one P.O. So for the Warlock to kill this, he's going to have to push a lot of abuses onto the board. And it's not looking super likely, all things considered. Where shall I strike? Get a big Baron push face. Forsen's in a really tricky spot here. He has to just develop the board and fall behind on tempo, giving his opponent the time to be proactive about removal.
Tice just isn't going to trade into that. There's no way.
Oh, oh my goodness. Tice is getting the draws.
Shredder, Hero Power, the 1-1, and then go face more.
Yeah, another 10. Looks unless like you want to recycle this, find a swipe. Yeah. Maybe find a
you
swipe.
Don't, you don't need a swipe. Well, for later you do.
Yeah.
But you just, you don't want to pop the Voidcaller whenever you're ahead on board. It just seems...
No, hell no.
Yeah.
Give him a Mal'Ganis, lose the game. And this is a story of how Druid just loses. Alright, so Thais, I don't know if he was considering making a trade here with the 1-1, but the only thing that punishes this is like a defend of Argus, buffing two minions. So I think one of the best ways for Forsen to come back is if that Doomguard comes out and allows him to kill the Shredder, but unfortunately for him, it's going to be the Voidcaller again.
No, nothing comes out. Is it a...
No, no, it's always the Voidcaller, believe me.
It's always the Voidcaller.
It's never what Forsen wants. So is he just dead? I think he's dead. Yeah, that's it. That's a good game. That was quick.
Yeah, that was Druid doing Druid things.
And it was the Voidcaller. See, I told you. It's always the Voidcaller.
Oh, going up 5-1. This is, like, just to get into the finals. Loser of this is eliminated, so...
Alright, so one thing to note here. Even if RDU had a 20% win rate against everything else from Forsen Boys, he is likely to move on and seal the entire series for his team. And again, this would be a huge win for Nihilim, which have been on the worst roller coaster ride that the entire league has seen so far, going from probably an almost secured, guaranteed spot in the top two, which was then stolen away from them when they lost with only 3 wins instead of 4, and then they went down the rankings to Oblivion, and they're climbing back. One win at a time. So if they win this match, they're going to move on to the live finale, and that's going to be for them kind of an awesome, I guess, finals to the streak to get that whole spot. Sure.
Getting there is like what everyone wants, obviously.
Yeah.
Get a chance to compete for 250,000 or your share of 250,000.
Jeez. It's going to be still rough for one of the teams making it up there since you've got like a 25, it's almost like a 25% chance to not get anything and then you go home with like a pair of kitchen knives. There's like absolutely nothing. There's not even a consolation prize, I think. I mean, Brian Kibbo and Value Town is getting something at the very least, right?
Oh, yeah, exactly. He's already gotten, he's gotten something.
Yeah, I think for him to be contested here, Shockey would have to get the live finale, but the Master of Duels is already sealed, right?
Yeah,
like the score can't possibly
go. Because it's from phase one, not from phase two. So RDU is going to have to find a win with the Shaman. Tiebreaker doesn't matter at all. So I don't think it matters what you send in at this point. You might want to do it for morale or something. Maybe send in your best matchup, which is Mage. I think it's Mage. Maybe Warlock is better. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think Zoo is slightly better for the most part. Just because if you deny the Shaman the board, then you can possibly just snowball out of it. Because the Shaman has no Whiplash mechanic. There's no Lightning Storm in his deck, right? Like, there's like 1% of the Shaman decks that run that. It's kind of non-existent. Oh, man.
Poor RDU's Ghostu Gamer. When you go last, you just get the worst matchups, and your Ghostu Gamer is just tanks.
You're right, fair, actually. Ghostu Gamers doesn't account for that awful position in a team league where you're just forced to play your the last match. So RDU picks up a pretty awful starting hand. The Anoitron's cute, but the rest is... irrelevant.
Yeah, I think you need something more aggressive for RDU. You just mulligan everything. You need Whirling Zap-O-Matics, Mechwarpers, Cogmasters, things that do stuff early. I expect Forsen to keep maybe the Doomsayer and probably the Frostbolt and
Doomsayer is a pretty good keep, I think. If only because it's going to be able to, like, you can drop it on a very early board, and if the Shaman doesn't have Earth Shock or like a huge amount of investment on burst to kill it, then very often you're just going to go away with the board and it's never going to come back. Oh, RDU picks up a nice curve here. That is insane. That is a really good. Sorry.
Wasn't the other Mech Shaman playing that? Wasn't Oskaka playing that?
Everybody's playing Tusker Totemic and Mech Shaman.
Mech Shaman. That's ridiculous. That's crazy.
Yeah, it's better in Mech Shaman than any other Shaman because it's the only consistent Shaman on the metagame.
Flame Tongue also.
That's unusual.
It's the only consistent one.
All right, so we'll see if the Doomsayer comes down here. I don't think so because you can just get a free kill with a ping, but Tuskar Totemic giving you a good totem, like a Manatide. Now that would make some people salty. Hey, RDU keeps getting the good cards. I didn't know Mech Shaman was a minion based deck.
That's so true. I don't know. I guess you have to play him. Like, what do you hope for?
Totem Golem, maybe? I'll take it. I mean, Manatide or Totem Golem. Like, pick one or the other. You got like a 25% chance to get a sick
easy
outcome.
Totem Golem.
Flame Tongue's also Flame pretty Tongue, sweet. Yeah, that's a whiff. It's a bit of a whiff. I mean, it might come in handy at some point.
Well, the thing is, you're running Flame Tongue, so eventually it's going to get value regardless just by it being there, which is good. And it makes sense to run Flame Tongue in this deck just because you're running Totemics.
Yeah, Totemics actually maybe incentivize Mech Shamans to run Flame Tongues because it was useless since the deck was mostly about, oh my goodness, double Flame Tongue.
You just go for it? Oh, you're playing one? Okay. Yeah, exactly. This is good.
And what does Forsen do? I mean, he's two turns away from Blizzard here.
You can just Frost Nova, and the next turn you can Frost Nova Doomsayer. Or if you're not threatened, and you feel like you can just take another 8, you can just play the barrier.
Yeah. Forsen's got way too many answers to this.
He's got this. This is, you know, Frost Nova Doomsayer into Blizzard into Flame Strike. There's just no way that RDU is going to push damage through board. He needs a weapon or something. I actually like him not committing anything here.
Yeah, he knows better.
Like,
unless he really wants to, like, go all in knowing that if it doesn't work out. I mean, it's such a bad matchup in the first place. Maybe going all in is the only way because you're so unlikely to get the lethal if you don't.
Maybe he'll top deck like Urshock into Lothen. I don't know. Yeah. He can clear this if he draws a Doomhammer or an Urshock or Hex. And
yeah, RDU probably knows this is not looking too good, and that must feel really good for Forsen, looking at all those minions disappear into nowhere. Well, rest in peace. Forsen's got double secret set up, another 8 health, and lethal prevention, plus his Archmage and the Alexstrasza. I think he can just sit back and relax while RDU tries to scramble back in the game.
Well, he can commit to board really hard here. Well, you can just play everything, right?
Yeah.
So
Shredder could give you something sick. Zap-O-Matic's not out of
Of course, he's just in such a good position because he actually had stuff to do that turn after he cleared. Because after the Doomsayer, you usually want to like make sure you develop a minion or you at least do something. And he was able to get both secrets up, which is crazy.
Yeah, there was no threat at all. Like sometimes when you get that board clear and you're at very low health, it's a problem because you're trying to scramble for cards when you need to just get card draw and you don't have anything yet. But he already had his options in hand. So RDU's best hope is probably a Doomhammer into another Rockbiter top deck. And then hoping that he can push for a huge amount of burst that a mage can't prevent. But I wouldn't bet on it.
Blizzard Doomsayer and Sea Ralph seems pretty strong.
So I would have liked Blood Mage. Just for the card.
Oh, really? Oh, just to clear? I like Doomsayer a little bit more just because you're guaranteed a board clear unless he wants to commit 7 damage to that. And then you get an Alex on board and then he can't.
Yeah, I guess he can't even play minions after that point either. So, well, RDU probably knows that the end is. Oh, well, hello.
That would have been good, yeah.
That would have been good a little earlier.
Yeah, I'm not sure if there's much RDU can do right now. It just he's even running Fellweaver.
That's weird. I mean, I haven't seen this in a while.
Yeah, his version seems like decent against Freeze Mage also. It just didn't draw Lotha at the right time. Forsen didn't even draw that amazingly, honestly. He just had the Frost Novas.
Alright, well, Forsen Boys is going to be able to get 5-2. It's a slow climb back, possibly, but we'll see. I mean, they've got the edge in that they can actually isolate the Shaman now if they want to get all the wins. But as you said, since everything has to go through the Shaman, might as well throw the worst matchups and hope it sticks.
Yeah, and Chalky's
tiebreaker doesn't matter
as well. I mean, he can throw in... I'm not sure what exactly is really that favorite against Mech Shaman, though. You might want to just go for the Zoo, and then Hunter should even be fine against it, I think. So those are two good matchups already. And then you have to go for a Mirror.
I think Zoo's fine, right? Because it is known as one of the better board control decks, and Shaman can't fight with it, so...
Yeah, I mean, ultimately, Force and Boy is just going to have to win every single thing against... against the Shaman. I'm curious, I don't know, it'd feel bad for RDU if he lost all of the matchups.
I think his Ghost of Gamers would never recover either. Like, not only would he never recover from it, but his rank might also tank.
How bad would that feel to, like, deny your team a chance to win 250,000 total prize pool, but
so to close too, right? Like, exactly. And this is, again, if he loses everything, this will literally be the roller coaster. I mean, there's nothing worse than this. They are so close to getting through. Even with all bad matchups, the odds are in RDU's favor that he wins at least one game by snowballing out of control. You know, Mech Shaman is good at this, right? They will steal games from anything at some point, given enough rolls on the starting hands. So it's just it's a matter of seeing whether or not this can win. Shalky's going to go for his aggro pally against the Shaman. I like that. There's no board clear on RDU's side, so not necessarily a bad matchup. Oh my god.
Strider, wow. That's really good starting hand also from RDU.
Yeah, RDU's got the coin too, which gives him...
Whoa! Chalky's hand is really good.
Both players' hands are amazing. I think the Anoyotron might be what breaks the deal. Oh man, this is such a painful start. So you have to sacrifice a Clockwork Gnome, basically.
You can just play Cogmaster here.
And then go Anoyotron, coin Clockwork.
Mm-hmm. I don't think you need to coin anything out right now.
So you want to coin the Shredder on turn three?
Well, yeah, that's probably correct. I don't think you get anything from just coining out the Clockwork Gnome right now, though. If you play Cog, you could have coined Anoyotron, I guess. That's not terrible. And the next turn, just play Cogmaster into. Clockwork Gnome. It looks like what he's going to do.
Alright, so he's going to try to deny the Argent Squire. It's a really good deny. Shaky with a pretty good top deck. To deny the deny.
I think you just play
Mini Bot. Down the line. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's the double Divine Shield versus single Divine Shield. We all know who wins that.
I need top deck Blood Knight. Easy game.
Oh man, RDU.
I don't know about that attack.
Wow.
Oh no, that's fine because he has muster for next turn. I'm sorry, that was good.
No, the attack's fine from Shaky's side because he can just use the weapon next turn to finish it off.
That draw is really good though. Dang. Turning up the heat.
Shaky's not going to be happy to see this, but then again, the Mech Warper is going to take either 2 damage or one of the Clockwork Gnomes dies. I expect the Clockwork Gnome to die, but if the Mech Warper doesn't die, which is unlikely to, then the Pilot of Shredder will come down next turn, and that's going to be a bit tough. It's a good thing that he's got the Iron Beak already.
Yeah, the Owl will help, and he chose to attack into that.
Alright, that's interesting. So we'll see whether or not that pays off. The spare parts can't really be played if you develop the Shredder, so they're not going to have an immediate impact. Do you just push face and let the Paladin make the trades, or are you so afraid of Consecration that you can't do that.
I don't think you can play around Consecration at this point. You can trade one Clockwork Gnome and then go face with the rest.
Yeah, I think the debate is whether or not you attack with the last Clockwork. But since he's got 3 1-1s, you kind of have to.
I like it because it protects your Shredder a little bit more.
Rusty Horn is pretty sweet as well. That's going to give you... Whoa. Oh, that's going to hurt a little bit down the line.
Huh.
Such an awkward turn for Shocky. You want to get rid of that Shredder, but you really can't. Maybe you just kill the 2 1-1s and then you Blessing of Kings. Yeah, Blessing of Kings is one of your guys and just push.
I don't mind that at all. I think that's good. Next turn you can go Owl into Muster.
Yeah, I think it's curving pretty nicely. If you like, if you play it for curve here from Shocky, from Shocky's side, I think it's perhaps a bit better. But those spare parts could be really big deals. I mean, imagine an emergency coolant on that Blessing of Kings recruit. That would give RDU quite a bit of time, and that Shredder is just going to stay up.
Great. Oh.
Whoa. All right. I mean, he does have the edge over the long game, right?
Yeah, he might be scared of an Earth Shock as well, something like that.
I can see that.
And like, those spare parts are actually going to kind of hurt RDU just because of Divine Favor.
Mm-hmm. You have to dump them as soon as you can, but...
Yeah, dumping taunts doesn't seem very advantageous.
So does he Rock Bite himself and kill a 5-1 and push face with a 2-2? Because the 2-2 represents 2 damage, but the Rock Biter represents potentially an extra 6 on a Doomhammer. Not that you can really play around it.
I think you'll lose if you don't fight for board, so I like Rock Biter.
What about kill the 1-1? What about kill the 1-1 with the 2-2 and Rusty Horn your totem?
That's not bad either.
Because it tanks to 5 damage, like, forcefully, right? And then the Muster kills the 2-2, I guess. The Light's Justice does. Ugh. This is not where RDU wanted to be at this stage of the game. Gotta make that trade. He's playing for value, and he's gonna taunt up the Cogmaster to make sure that a trade occurs between the 5-1 and the 1-2.
I mean, his board is gone.
Yeah, goodbye board. You will be missed. Well, Lothab's a bit tricky, but the Abusive can deal with her pretty nicely. With him, rather.
I think just playing the Owl right now, yeah. And then pushing the 5, or even killing the Totem is fine. And mustering some solid. And I like RDU that he's dumping his hands because he's scared of...
Divine Favor?
Divine Favor, yeah, exactly.
Oh my god, that's a sick top deck for RDU. That's going to put... That's going to turn up the heat. Shocky is going to have to pick up an Equality, and... otherwise, he doesn't play Aldor. We pretty much know that for a fact. So is this time to race? You're going to find 3 cards off Divine Favor, so again, not too bad either.
Can you kill it? Wait, there's 5 on board. Six.
You can kill it, but you're going to have to face tank 8. Yeah.
I wonder if that's... Oh, he can just play everything and then Divine Favor and see what he gets and base his attacks based on what he draws.
And I would be... I want to shut my eyes when I play Fellreaver, because looking at those cards disappear just hurts me inside. Oh, Rogue Batter gone. Doomhammer is still in.
Okay, so. You go face because you drew the Argus. I'm pretty sure.
So you kill a spell damage, not get blown out with like a double crackle turn, and then you push for
a long. You know he runs Flame Tongue as well, so it's worth killing totems generally. Right now he's considering just making the 3 damage go into the 8-8, just because, you know, the Abusive gets value that way, or if he wants to go face with it.
But that Rusty Horn is going to be pretty annoying. The thing is, like, you don't expect you to have any more cards after next turn if you RDU, basically, right? Mm-hmm. It's almost... wait, how much damage is that? So he's on 13 health. Lothab, Rusty Horn.
What are you, Rusty Horn? You're Rusty Horn, you're Lothab, right?
Probably, because that Fellreaver gives you lethal next turn if he doesn't taunt up.
Exactly. Does it give
well,
you... Yeah, it
in theory, it should, but Lothab's going to fall down, and that's going to stop it.
Better an Argus.
Yeah, you already know Shocky's running Argus, but can you play around it? I mean, there's no way. There's too many mids on the board. Like, nothing you do will really change that.
He's going to end up taunting Lothab, I think. Oh, wow.
He's going to push for it. Oh, man.
What is he hoping to draw into next turn? He can't lethal him next turn if he tries to top deck something.
Well, wait.
Maybe if Lotheb lives.
The thing is, your minions have taunt by default, because they're going to kill your opponent. That's how you kind of look at it if you're RDU, right?
Yeah. But you can protect your Fellreaver. Because he can't clear both, but maybe he opts to just clear the Fellreaver.
RDU okay, kills a minion with this, alright. Let's see.
That actually was pretty good, I think.
So, just trade into Lotheb. And well, you don't have to, you like, you just push Argus. Face and hero power defender.
I like Argus into Dude, and then just smork him, maybe.
Yeah, I mean, it's really hard to imagine RDU coming back from a board state like this. I mean, Earthshock on the shield mini boss is the best case scenario. Power Maze, the other one down, and then you have lethal, actually. Yeah. Actually.
I mean, how are you going to deal with the shielded mini bot that's taunted?
Yeah, you absolutely need Earthshock. So this is it. This is the moment to see if RDU can top deck the Earthshock, because if he does, he wins this. Unless Lotheb is traded into by Shocky. But he has to face tank 5, which means he still wins. RDU with one top deck. And that is the Earthshock. I don't think I've seen any get milled.
Yeah. Well, I don't think he runs Earthshock.
Well, if he doesn't, then that's GG.
Oh, this is a safe play, right? Oh, no, it's not.
Alright, RDU with one top deck. If he runs Earthshock, there's a chance he doesn't. He looked very sad when he saw the fact that his opponent taunted up.
I don't think you can fit the Earthshock in this deck. You're running too much. Like, you're running double Tuskar Totemic, you're running Fellreavers. I just don't see how he would ever fit it in.
So you're gonna have to try. I mean, the Annoyatron is tanking a bit of damage. The question is whether or not you're gonna be able to
I think the game's over, right?
Annoyatron, even with the Rusty Horn.
Oh, with the Rusty Horn, you're right, actually. Oh, wow. Forgot about that Rusty Horn.
Yeah, so he's got to go through a total of one Divine Shield, so that's like, let's say, one damage, and 8. So that's one damage plus 8 to go directly. That might be the card that does it. This might be the card that does it. Is it, though?
2.
I think he's one off.
A 6. 6 there, that there. He's not more, he's a lot off, I think.
So, ping, South Sea. 1, 2, 3. He's gonna be 2 off. Yeah, you're right. He's 2 off at the very best.
Play Lotheb and Hero Power, I guess.
Well, there's a chance that RDU can do it, because even if he picks up a Lava Burst and Lotheb comes down, he can still win this. RDU could take it. I haven't seen Lava Burst yet. Maybe he cut those. I didn't see them get milled. I saw the Crackles go, but
I think he runs 1.
Doomhammer's out. Lava Burst. Oh my god. Oh, the double Lava Burst.
He needs to play the other card, that way he mills more cards.
That is it, I think. RDU has no more win conditions. He wouldn't have been able to keep... Maybe there's like no way for him to keep a...
He has one card deck.
Okay, yeah, there was no way he was going to end up with a deck, no matter what. He had to hope the last card was going to be Lava Shock. What's left in his deck now? Another Rockbiter. I think I've seen that already.
Earthshock. He's running Earthshock. There you go.
He could have had it.
He could have won. He could have top decked into lethal.
He could have. It was possible. RDU is going to go down again with a Shaman. And Force and Boys will be able to slowly creep back up to possibly equalize the series very soon. Again, they still have to win the entire thing. And RDU can probably maybe get a single win against the rest of the field.
Man, that Shaman deck. I don't know. It's not bad. It's just...
It's inconsistent. That's what Shaman does, right?
If it's 50-50 against everything, there's a chance you're going to lose. Like, you don't have very favorable matchups, I feel like. Except for Druid, but they didn't bring Druid, did they?
It was actually pretty interesting because, like, with a 50% win rate against everything, before you look at your 5 matches, you're like, okay, surely I'm going to win one of those, right? but then as you go into either of them, you feel like you're about to get crushed. Make Shaman against Hunter. How bad or good is it? I get the feeling Shaman has a pretty good chance.
I think Hunter wins that matchup. I think Zoo wins the matchup as well.
I agree.
I think the Shaman versus Shaman is going to... Like, obviously, it's not 100% win. It's just a little favored. You know, maybe 60%. Maybe 65 or something. But so the shaman can obviously win those matchups, but you know, you might as well send in the good matchups first and then go for the 50-50 with the mech shaman versus mech shaman.
I mean, a coin flip at worst against Oskaka and bad matchups again. I think the Hunter versus Shaman isn't that polarized, is it? Because like from my perspective, if they both smork, which they often do, Shaman has spells that do more damage on average.
That's true.
But like if it comes down to that, but the thing is, their opponents have the inevitability, of course.
I think so, it's more that Hunter has. What does Hunter have? Hunter has.
Quick shot, kill command.
No, they have two drops. They have really important ones. They have creepers, they have jugglers, and they have mad scientists, which give them a ton of tempo. They also have decent early game weapons that can deal with stuff. Like imagine you drop a mad scientist and it trades with their Cogmaster. Then you get a freezing trap. Then suddenly you get tempo on board.
Can they trade with Cogmaster though? Because like, I think that's a mistake to trade as Mech Shaman against Hunter.
That's true, but I mean you could just run it in for yourself. You also run a lot more one drops if you're playing aggro Hunter. I think it's a little favored for Hunter. I'm not saying it's like, you know, crazy favored, because obviously Shaman can get like a good curve and win. It looks like they're going to go for their Shaman versus Shaman matchup.
All right, if they feel that's the worst matchup, then they're just queuing in what they think could lose more often than not. Or maybe they're just asking people to vote or to just raise their hand. If you're willing to go up against RDU, just raise your hand. They send someone. Let's go to volunteers. And as a coin flip matchup, it can go either way. Both players are very proficient and they run a pretty similar list where RDU, however, has the Fellreaver where Oskaka doesn't. Alright, RDU with a decent curve, but the Anoyatron's there to contest and the Zap-O-Matic is on both sides. Start is not bad for RDU. The Cogmaster is really annoying. Whoever plays it first gets the edge, but the Anoyatron is also a good way to stop the Cogmaster from doing anything, really. RDU is stressed. He realizes everything is hinging on me right now. I am the team. I am the guy who can carry or lose this. Oh, Oskaka with a double Zap-O-Matic. Good thing there's a power maze for RDU. Good thing. Uh-oh. Alright, so...
This is weird.
This is a really weird situation for Oskaka. Because if you want to protect the Zap-O-Matics, you're feeding him Anoyotrons consistently. So you have to pray that he doesn't have a Zap-O-Matic to get, you know, double hits or Power Mace on the following turn to start removing your stuff. So I think RDU still has an edge here. Yeah, I think the edge is actually quite substantial, actually, yeah. Like in this
situation. It's the weapon, and going first with a curve is good. Very, very good, because you're always a turn ahead, basically. And using the coin and aggro matchups and not gaining tempo, because this was just basically the contested board. He got a little tempo, but not very much. It was, like, really, really bad. He doesn't attack in.
Yeah, he wants to keep it with the weapon. Now, Oskaka might feel comfortable enough to drop a Zap-O-Matic, but with the Power Mace coming up, that's going to be a slight mistake, since it's actually not going to do anything. And in fact, it's going to leave RDU with two minions on the board. This line of play from RDU guaranteed that both his minions survived, because if he attacked with a Cogmaster, then attack with an Anoyotron to the Cogmaster and play another Anoyotron, in this case for Oskaka, would have worked wonders if he had removal for the Zap-O-Matic. So I really like RDU's line of play.
Yeah, that was good. It kind of stinks, the aggro versus aggro matchups, because you're kind of pigeonholed into playing these cards.
You mean on tempo, no matter what happens?
Well, like, in aggro versus aggro, you kind of just play your lowest curve card most of the time, but there are little things you can do, like what Oskaka just did, right? He attacked into the Whirling Zap-O-Matic with his thing. That gives you a little edge. There are little things you can do. But sometimes you get pigeonholed into playing bad cards or suboptimally just because you drew poorly.
Yeah, Oskaka's play here was top-notch, right? Because he realizes if I play double Anoyotron, then I really can't kill the Zap-O-Matic, unless I attack it first. All right, so the question is, will RDU force his opponent to make the trade? Or will he make it himself? Like, is there a reason not to do that?
I mean, The only way he wouldn't trade is a misplay or a score or something. Yeah. So
Earthshock perhaps would be an issue, like you lose a minion for free, but you already lose a minion for free either way.
I like just trading, like there's no point in waiting.
Yeah, you know he's going to make the trade. You're just opening yourself up for potential bad outcome. All right, well, RDU with the Power Maze dropping on the Shredder if he wants it next turn. Possibly he's going to be able to top deck another mech for the Mech Warper, depending on how things go, but it's looking like so far he's got the edge, but those Fire Guard Destroyers could come in and ruin his day.
Yeah, you don't really want to be using the Lightning Bolt here just because you need to be curving into the Fire Guards.
Right.
But there lies the issue. If he has another mech next turn, he's just going to attack in, and then he has like a huge board, and it's going to feel bad, man.
And this is actually the worst case scenario. RDU picks up a Crackle, or I mean, these two Crackles are amazing because the amount of damage they represent means you can actually go face without being worried of lacking burst. So RDU probably feels very good right now. Like this is a position where he's got to feel a bit more comfortable than he was at the beginning of the game. This could be it. I wonder how tense he is right now. I'd like to have his heart rate.
Ugh. Yeah, you have to play Fire Guard. I agree. 5 attack, that's good enough.
You just smork it, right? Like
I think smorking it's right, yeah. I think going face is fun. Mm-hmm.
You have the edge. I mean, you've got 9 damage on him right now. And look at the board. Because no player is playing Lightning Storm, like Oskaka playing from behind means that he's going to spend his attacks on killing smaller minions or equal size minions. And meanwhile, RDU just keeps putting down threats. And that's the weakness of aggro. Like, this is kind of why the Mech Shaman Mirror is so volatile. Because when you look at, say, Mirror Match Hunter, the Unleash is a good whiplash mechanic. Right? Like, in many cases, you can play Unleash to come back from a bad position, but from Oskaka's perspective, there's nothing to swing him back in the game.
Yeah.
That's a decent play from him, so you can just bolt the 3-2 if you want.
Yeah, that's actually not too terrible. That's a good play. You're right. Mech Warper into Whirling and then just bolt. Try to force your opponent to trade. You could even play the Fire Guard Destroyer next turn. That's just... it's hard to come back from this position for sure. Party is going to have to get some pretty bad draws.
I mean, the thing is, if RDU decides to play defensively here, like if he doesn't pick up a weapon, he might not feel confident enough to push. Like if he picks up kind of an early game minion, oh, never mind, that's good enough.
He's going to have to kill the Whirling Zap-O-Matic. So do you crackle it? Yeah, and then just play those two and go face.
Mm-hmm.
Might even feel inclined to protect his Annoyatron.
Hey, you could kill that. There's no drawback to killing the Mech Warper and denying your opponent, because by playing defensively, I guess here, what he's doing is he's playing like Zoo. And if you're getting the Zoo play over your Mirror Match Shaman, then I think you're winning. So, like, no matter which line of play he takes here, I think he's going to be in a pretty good spot. The only time where things like this backfire is when, Earth shocks fall down with a weapon.
Yeah, exactly.
That's about it.
Yeah, you can't really get punished for trading too. Well, you can, but in this case, I don't think you can get punished for trading too much. So I don't mind it. Just playing it safe. You even get value from the healing totem.
All right, nothing here will go through this Annoyatron for a long time to come. Oskaka's looking like he's even further on the back foot, and RDU must be looking at this like it's already a victory. Might try the Tuskar Totemic and hope for a dream.
A bug. Just a Doomsayer Totem.
Blizzard, what is this? Doomsayer Totem. Oh, this is good. Imagine this, though. That'd be great. It's like the story of that guy who was playing a game with a Shredder on the board. The a cut purse out of Shredder, and he got extra coins that won him the game. Like, he didn't know what was happening. He's like, what is this card? I don't even know what this is.
Actually happened to me the other day. I got a cut purse off like an effigy or something, and I had a Flame Waker on board. I attacked face and I dropped another Flame Waker and Arcane Missile, and his whole board is cleared. He was so mad.
Poor guy.
Cut purse is sick.
It's a sick snowball potential card. I think it needs a little bit exploration. So RDU keeps punching face, finds another layer of taunts, and he's looking at lethal in the next few turns, if not next turn. So, unless there's a miracle, Tuskar Totemic into Stoneclaw. Into double Stoneclaw here for Oskar.
Double Stoneclaw. Into somehow dealing with the board.
Paladin Shredder, and then you pop his Shredder. You Lava Burst his Shredder, Doomsayer comes out. You top deck Doomhammer into Rockbiter. RDU gets nothing but garbage. It's not completely over. There is some RNG in the game that exists that could swing this back in Oskaka's favor, but it's not looking good. Picks up a Totem Golem. All right, one of the better outcomes, but it's a bit too late, it feels.
Is that lethal on board? That's 6, 10, 11.
Missing one.
It's off, off by one.
So any top deck does it. He's seen two Cogmasters, which are basically the only dead draws at this stage that do no damage. Maybe one. The other Annoyotron also isn't lethal.
Oh.
Everything else kind of is. And RDU is
happy. Oh man, he's
happy.
So happy. He was going to win that anyways, I feel like. I don't know. I don't think that was a defining moment in the game.
Yeah, he's just happy that the pressure can be taken off of his shoulders. He's like, you know what? I'm done with this. Nihilim is moving on to the finals after the grueling series of matches they've had to play in the Archon Team League. So congratulations to them, Force and boys. We will see you on the losing bench, I guess, alongside some of the other teams out there. So we're down to the top four at this stage. That was a really intense finish for Nihilim. Hopefully they'll do, you know, for them, for their sake, that they don't finish fourth place in the grand finals. So based on this, we have Nihilim and Temple Storm moving on to the live finals. It's kind of interesting because Temple Storm beat Nihilim yesterday, but Nihilim still makes it after going through so many matches. I think they are the team that has had to play alongside Force and Boys the most matches in the league, and Force and Boys and them fought off at the very end there. Really intense. Wow, what a relief for them.
Yeah, I actually expected Force and Boys to be one of the teams that make it, just because they have individually pretty good players. Nihilim I expected to make it as well. I expected them to be top of the groups and get out. But, I mean, they made it through the phase two, which is good.
Yeah, it's always a little tricky, right? It was a bumpy road. Like, getting to the finals for Nihilim was a bumpy road, but they finally got there. So this is the one and only match we had to cast today. It was a great one. Man, that RDU relief, I guess, clapping of the hands at the end there. He seemed so happy. It's kind of rare that you see him being happy when he displays emotions on stream. So. Usually it's all the salt, right, that pours out. All right, well, do you have any last words before we wrap this up, dog?
No, I think I'm good.
All right, so before we go, guys, a quick shout out to the partners. We've got alphadraft.com. Obviously, you want to check them out. Esports Fantasy League, alphadraft.com. They can match up to $250 of your deposit. Go ahead, dog. What?
Oh, no. I was trying to point at it. It's really hard. It's like over there.
Oh, yeah, it's kind of over there. Yeah, that's right.
Exactly.
So you can just check them out, get a share of the huge amount of money that they give out each week. And Amazon App Store also doing promotions, 50% discount on 40 card packs. Check them out on teamarcon.com/Amazon or amazon.com/Hearthstone. Also, huge thanks to Amaz for organizing the entire event. This has been really, I mean, the production value of this is, to me, pretty stellar. The matches are on point. The players are sick. Just organizing the whole thing has been really amazing. So I'm pretty happy to be a part of this. We'll be back with a live finals, which is going to happen a little later next month. It's going to be actually live from Texas. You're going to be there, dog, if I'm not mistaken. So we should see each other there as I'll be casting some of the mashes. So yeah, we'll meet live. What about that?
Oh, man.
So guys, thanks for watching today. We'll see you next month. Have a nice one.